This court now resumes this session. Please be seated.
Ms. Renshaw, please turn on your video and audio.
All right, we'll move on to the third argument of the day, Donald McDougall versus County of Ventura, case number 20-56220. And Mr. DiGiuseppe, we'll hear from you again.
Good morning again. May it please the court again. Ray DiGiuseppe on behalf of the plaintiffs. I think just to avoid any unnecessary rehashing, I'll probably reserve maybe 10 minutes of the time, if I could. And just beyond that, to get a little bit more into detail about what we were just discussing in the related case, the rights that were implicated in this situation were across the board, across the spectrum, not like anything we've seen with the existing Ninth Circuit cases. And each of the cases where the court has applied intermediate scrutiny and upheld the restriction, there's been a lesser extent of restraint, and there's been a showing of some interest that's been tied to the claimed means that's being used with some kind of evidence or explanation that is grounded in fact. Whereas in this situation, we just have an absence of that, an absence of any consideration at the forefront. And then in this case, extending on for 48 some odd days until the order was finally lifted. We're really in land.
Can I ask a question? Can I ask a question about mootness here? Sure. I was on a case last year and dissented and said that the case was what should have been found moot, and that dealt with the ballot initiatives where they had to get signatures and they had to do it by a certain deadline and it wasn't done. And I mean, part of my dissent, I said, you know, this is unique circumstances. We're not going to see a pandemic like this again. Number one, I lost, so it was a dissent. So maybe that doesn't bind us. But is this distinguishable from the ballot box? I mean, I think the point's been made, and I hope that everybody understands Second Amendment rights need to be, you know, more protected. We're not going to see orders like this again. So what makes us think that this is capable of repetition yet evading review?
Yeah, I understand your question, Your Honor. Thank you. I wish that we could say with confidence we won't see orders like that again, but with the reservations of power expressly stated in the orders, I don't know that that's something we can count on. Plus, since they didn't give it any weighted consideration, they just did it. And now, granted, they were sued, but it would be even that much more perverse to now turn around and say, well, you're not even at least responsible for the past injury that you did inflict because it's moot. And so wipe your hands of it and you're free to go.
Well,
see
but
you
that's
later.
That's an Hope argument you that, that you, I mean, seems to be that nominal damages is enough to protect it from mootness.
Well, that does go to the past.
If we were going to get out of mootness, is that the way we should go, or should we look at capable of repetition yet evading review?
Well, I think we could and should look at both, because nominal damages by itself will keep the case alive for purposes of adjudicating what's already happened. But the concern about any kind of repetition of this and the need to make a declaration that's holding going forward so that litigants can't effectively challenge these types of things because it happens to be short-lived. I mean, even 48 days, it's a long time in the world of the firearms industry, but that's not much time in the litigation world. So I think for that doctrine, yes, I mean, it's a formidable burden either way, however you slice it. And this court recently said in the Brack case and emphasized how essentially they're looking for, or at least the main factor is, has the defendant expressly forswore doing this again, or at least done something to suggest you've got an entrenched change of policy. It's not like the Dark Storm case, for example, where the Second Circuit affirmed that one. Well, there, the legislature came out and issued some kind of statutory remedy whereby it bound the governor's ability to be able to issue some kind of restrictions like this again. We don't have that. We have the public health officer still retaining these powers. There's nothing that's happened at a legislative level locally or at the state level to prevent that kind of exercise of executive power again unilaterally. So I think that a statement like in the in the religious freedom cases, association cases, to the effect that it would bind the defendants from engaging these types of orders again is important. I mean, that it's important to so we don't waste additional resources and time with litigating over this again, because that's what would happen if this were to happen again. And
so,
given
I want to, if you don't mind, I know you want to reserve 10 minutes, but that's a lot of time.
Sure.
So
that's fine.
I'm going to use some
sure.
of your 10 minutes, that's right, for a different
Absolutely.
Line of question. I think
that's
we've
fine.
Had. You know, we've got these cases from the Supreme Court, Tandon, and those line of cases. They're all in the First Amendment context, specifically religious
right.
liberties, and they turn very heavily on the neutrality issue, the fact that it seems like religion is being treated differently than things, other activities that mm-hmm. that are not actually enumerated rights. It's a little bit, and so here, of course, we're talking about the Second Amendment. To what extent does that neutrality? This case does present sort of a neutrality issue. We've talked already in the other argument about bike shops, and I think in this case we've got golfing versus various things related to firearms. But it's not perfectly clear how neutrality plays in the Second Amendment. I'm not sure I've seen any other cases involving neutrality outside the First Amendment context. So can you talk a little bit about why neutrality, whether that those principles apply here? And if so, how?
Yes, Your Honor. So perhaps it's not called neutrality per se. I don't think it has to be. But the principle underlying it is certainly applicable. And part of the way we get to the jurisprudence in the First Amendment is that the Supreme Court and this court repeatedly has invoked the First Amendment jurisprudence, free speech cases, in interpreting and applying the standards of intermediate scrutiny. Even you have it in Bauer, Fayok, and in Jackson repeatedly. In the Jackson case, actually relied specifically on several cases, two of which were full, were the Ward and the Fox cases. And if you look at those cases, those are the ones that say the burden's on the government to affirmatively establish some reasonable fit, right? That's how we're getting closer to this neutrality question.
Let me make sure. I think I know where you're going, which is to say, even without applying the neutrality principle, the same way it's been applied in the First Amendment context, particularly with regard to religion, but also with regard to content neutrality, et cetera, that when you're looking at the reasonableness of the fit, this whether or not other activities for which they haven't provided any distinguishing feature, if they're allowed, but firearm-related activities are not allowed, then it just shows that it's not a reasonable fit. So it's more, it's not so much neutrality per se, but it gives you something for reasonable fit that you don't see in other cases sometimes.
Right. But I think the underlying concept, if there's no showing from the government at all, like in this case, no showing at all that there's some specific risk or danger that subsists within the firearm industry that's independent of and different from these other industries like cannabis dispensaries, for example, was one of them. You know, if there's no showing there, then there's nothing. You have a void. And if you have a void, there's obviously an absence of any kind of fit. And if the safety protocols are readily available and under the standards like in the in the McCullen case, interestingly, the briefing of this case, the defense says that the McCullen standard actually controls for purposes of intermediate scrutiny. And that was where the Supreme Court said that the government must show it seriously undertook to address the problem with the least restrictive tools readily available to it. That's, I think, what's really intended by the standard of fitness. And so if in this situation the
on that counsel, but that goes
right.
back to, I mean, I hear you on that, and that's what I think of when I think of reasonable fit. I'm not sure that I agree with you that that's how our court has applied reasonable fit. They've really watered down the reasonable fit requirement in the context of the Second Amendment, and we're bound by that. I guess your argument is right, they haven't completely done away with it, and as long as they haven't completely done away with it, there's no fit at all in this case. And so as long as they haven't completely done away with the reasonable fit requirement, then even under intermediate scrutiny, you think you prevail.
There has to be a catch there. It can't, because otherwise there's no test whatsoever. There's nothing to the notion that the government must carry a burden to establish anything. If they can just state a reason which doesn't have a direct connection to the means that are chosen.
But they haven't, but here they haven't stated any, just to be clear, I don't, is your position they haven't stated any reason at all other than just the general COVID, mm-hmm. COVID reason that applies to bike shops and golf courses and
right.
pot dispensaries.
Right, and they, that is a reason, that's the interest they've taken. And just as in the religious freedom cases, you know, that's fully acknowledged as to stopping the spread of the pandemic and the COVID, well, of course that's a compelling interest. There is nothing to the test unless there's a tailoring element. And there's nothing to a tailoring element if it, they can just back out of it by saying, oh, well, we don't have to choose the least restrictive alternative. If that literally means any available alternative, they don't have to choose it if it's lesser. No, the only way it can make sense is if they don't have to choose the least possible restrictive condition, whatever that might be, you know, something lesser than what it is, but that's not as much as what they granted others. In the absence of any kind of showing, and here when you're implicating every aspect of the spectrum of rights, which this court has recognized as being protected, there's gotta be tailoring, a real tailoring, and neutrality, maybe not what we call it in this context, but to the extent this court finds applicable and persuasive, the Supreme Court authorities, which is the recent one cases, and they're the most on point as far as how do we deal with tailoring in the world of pandemic? It's not Jacobson, they're saying, but those are really illustrative in helping us understand that at least that the government has to make an effort to show and then demonstrate that these other alternatives, which are readily available, not just anything and everything, but they're readily available, no reason why they wouldn't work here just as well. They've got to make some kind of showing there, or it just doesn't make sense. And I'll reserve the rest of the time unless you have any more questions at this point.
I think we're fine. Yep. Okay, so Ms. Renshaw, you may proceed.
Good morning. May it please the court. Christine Renshaw on behalf of Appalese.
Ms. Renshaw, can I go ahead and just jump in here on the same question that I was asking your opposing counsel from, and that is this whole, this neutrality, it's a little bit difficult to see how these Supreme Court cases, the Tandon case, the Newdow cases, those cases relate here because of the fact that they turn on sort of an established neutrality principle that's been applied in the First Amendment, both in speech and in religious liberty, and so it's not clear to me how that applies in the Second Amendment context. I think your opposing counsel says, well, if you don't call it neutrality, you could call it, you know, it goes to fit. I guess it undermines any view that it's there's a fit. But one reason that occurred to me why the neutrality principle, we don't see it in the Second Amendment, is because, you know, guns are by nature, they're dangerous, more dangerous than some other things. And so oftentimes it would be difficult to find a comparator for, you know, in the religious liberty context, you'll say, you know, you're not allowing somebody to go to synagogue, but you're allowing somebody to, you know, go do something that's basically the equivalent of synagogue, right? Like go to a sports event or something like that. And so the comparator is, whereas in the gun context, finding a comparator can sometimes be difficult because of the inherently dangerous aspect of guns, right? So you'd have to, you know, are bikes as dangerous as guns, right? You know, that might be. But here, I think this is a unique case in that the reason for the regulation here has nothing to do, as I understand it, and correct me if I'm wrong, it had nothing to do with any inherently dangerous aspect of guns, unlike most gun regulations, you know, waiting periods, all these things that our courts considered. Instead, the regulation was solely based on concerns about the spread of COVID. So in that sense, the inherently dangerous aspect of guns sort of goes out the window. And so you really, it's sort of a unique case where the comparative aspect is more squarely presented, because the real question is just, is it more dangerous to buy a bike than to buy a gun? Or is it more dangerous to ride bikes outdoors than to shoot guns outdoors? And so how does that, so given all of that, why wouldn't it make sense to look at the comparative aspect, the neutrality aspect, similar to the way the Supreme Court's done in these recent, the Tandon case, the Newdow case, et cetera? Do you follow the question?
Yes, Your Honor, and it does not apply here. And I think what's getting lost in the translation is that, you know, the goal of the Ventura County Health Order was to keep everyone at home, and only those essential workers and those businesses that support essential workers, like bike stores. And medicinal marijuana and
ride their bikes at home, counsel. Like, how are they going to ride their bikes at home? I mean, they have a little bike track at home, or
those using their bikes to commute to work for who are essential workers. We have a large bike.
Is that what the restriction was? So you had to show that you worked in a essential worker industry, and then you could get your bike fixed, or you could buy a bike. But if you didn't work in essential, if you worked at a gun shop, you couldn't get your bike worked on?
That's not what I was saying, that the bike stores were to help support essential workers to allow them to do their essential work.
I mean, you don't see bicyclists commuting on the I-5 or the 210 or the 134. Did the order say this is for bicyclists who need bicycles to commute to essential work?
You know, Your Honor, like under Jacobson, it allowed the Ventura County Health Officer to act quickly and swiftly to help keep the essential workers and essential businesses open. And it wasn't just, you know, repair stores for bicycle shops. It was also auto repair stores as well, to keep people being allowed to
I don't think you heard my question. It sounds to me as though the order says bicycle shops are essential, bicycle shop workers are essential, they can go to work, they don't have to stay home. But it doesn't limit people going to the bicycle shop to buy a bicycle to essential workers. There's nothing about whether the customers have to be essential workers, and there's no particular reason to suppose that the customers would be essential workers, unless I missed some language in the order. And if I did, I'd like you to educate me.
And maybe I misspoke, Your Honor. What I was trying to say is not just essential workers, but for people to be able to use bikes to go, whether it's to get their groceries, whether it's to go get their medication, whether,
look, you know, you're really not responding to my question. Here's a speculation I have. The public health official thinks bicycling is good because it is outdoor exercise and makes people healthier. Guns are bad because guns kill people. And in that sense, favoring the good and opposing the bad, without any attention whatsoever to the spread of COVID, the public health officer says, you can go out to buy a bicycle, you can't go out to buy a gun. Now, what I'm looking for from you is where the public health officer or something else in the record says people need bicycles in order to go to work at the grocery store or go to work at the pharmacy. So those people can go out and buy bicycles. And of course, we have to keep the bicycle stores open so that they can buy their bicycles. I don't see anything like that, but I might have overlooked it because there's an awful lot of paper here.
You're correct, Honor. There was nothing specifically in the order that said only essential workers or those using their bicycles could go and buy them. However, this case, there is nothing in our Ventura County order as well that specifically says that you can't own a gun, you can't use a gun, you're prevented from shooting.
Counsel, to be clear, your order does say, Counsel, to be clear, your order does say you can't own a gun if you don't already own a gun. Because there's no way to own one for almost 2 months if you add the 10-day waiting period.
And it also says you can't use a gun at an outdoor firing range.
At an outdoor firing range, but there's nothing that says you can't use it on your own property or the other regulations that you can. And I wanted to address
Hollywood star with a Hollywood star with a 20-acre lot could use a gun on his own property. People in apartment houses and quarter-acre lots, and they can't use a gun on their property.
Well, this court has repeatedly upheld the waiting periods to purchase firearms in the Sylvester case.
Never but I upheld do want a 2-month waiting period, Counsel, right? What effectively was in this case?
Well, there was on April 20th, if you had started the purchase of a gun prior to March 20th, you could complete those sales. And then when it was deemed no longer posing a risk, then on May 7th, the order was lifted.
Why did the risk lift? That's what I'm confused about. What changed? May 7th, there was no longer a risk from COVID? Like, what happened that they started recognizing that this would be essential workers now?
As the restrictions started to ease and our health officer repeatedly looked at what was going on with our hospital numbers, with the COVID infections, then they were eased. And on May 7th, it was eased for the purchase and sale of guns. Now, under Penal Code 17030,
Is that in the record that the reason that the gun sale ban was ended was that the public health statistics on COVID had changed?
There was in the record, there is from our health officer that they repeatedly looked and as the were able to ease restrictions and open up more of our county, their bans were, you know, there were various other businesses that were allowed to open.
I don't recall this in the record, but it's a big record. So just tell me the excerpt of record citation. Yeah, I'm sure you have a yellow sticky on it.
It is. It's on my floor. It's in the declaration of Dr. Levin. And I do apologize. I do not have it readily available.
Thanks.
But I did want to address from our companion case, there was the issue raised about purchasing the guns on the sidewalks. And under Penal Code 17030, you are unable to have a unloaded or a loaded weapon and on a public street or public position. So that wasn't an option for the county to allow at that time or any time.
Wait a minute, counsel. So when you go up to buy a gun, you go into the gun store and you purchase it in the gun store, but you're parked outside on the street. So do you have to like throw it over into your back of your pickup truck, or how do you get it from one to the other? And if you do it the way I'm thinking you probably do it, then what's the difference between that and, you know, meeting a guy halfway there, shaking his hand and signing some paperwork? Well, maybe not shaking his hand. That's right. We don't want to do that because we don't want to spread COVID. Standing at arm's length and handing the gun across.
Again, under the penal code that it is prohibited.
So you can't walk out of a gun store? So that doesn't make sense to me. You can't walk out of a gun store to your car without breaking the law in California?
You cannot have it in an open area, so you could not exchange a gun or complete the steps necessary for the sale of a gun under Penal Code 17030 in California on a public sidewalk.
Like duffel bag. Could you do that? Like what if you just handed the black duffel bag across?
My understanding, that's not when I purchase guns, that's not the process. You have to load it and unload it. You have to show it. You have to do your steps. So, that's not allowed to be on a public street.
So this is important, actually, because it seems like you're justifying your restriction of not allowing firearms by relying on either state or local laws that make it very difficult, more difficult than almost anywhere else in the nation, to buy firearms or ammunition. So, for instance, I mean, let's talk about the ammo ban a second. So for the most states, you could just order ammunition delivered to your house, like everybody was doing during the pandemic. But you can't do that in California. So it seems to me that you're relying on that as justifying your restriction. But how can it be that if you already have restrictions that have barely passed intermediate scrutiny, that those somehow justify further restrictions? You see the problem with that lot? I mean, in some sense, pretty soon you could just ban guns because you follow it back, and at each step, it seemed justified. At some point, it gets to be too much for a constitutionally protected right.
And I understand Your Honor's position. However, this order did not ban guns. It did not ban someone from owning, possessing,
right, but it banned it banned purchases of guns for 2 months.
It limited it. You were unable to purchase a gun.
It banned new sales of guns
for a limited period of time, and those waiting periods.
How much? Tell me how long is too long. What if it had been 2 years? Would that have been a violation of the Second Amendment? In your view, 2 months is okay, but 2 years, a 2 year ban would have violated the Second Amendment.
I think under the case law of this court, that this was a temporary measure. This was not
a
long
term. Is 2 years a temporary? I mean, California has come in here and argued that banning sales to minors from 18 to 21 is temporary. That's 3 years. So in your view, is a 2 or 3 year ban temporary?
I would not agree that would be temporary.
Is 6 months temporary? I mean, you understand the problem. Like, at some point, the Second Amendment, you agree that at some point, the Second Amendment kicks in.
I would agree that if it was not a pandemic like we had here, and we did not have the case law and the Jacobson, that there would be some point that the Second Amendment would kick in. However, that is not what we are dealing with here. We are dealing with a temporary closure of non-essential businesses that just so happens to include gun and ammunition stores and firearm ranges. And it's facially neutral. It did not prohibit anyone who already owned a gun, ammunition, or using a gun. And if the court is not inclined to apply the Jacobson framework, that intermediate scrutiny, the Ventura County health orders clearly pass muster at that level. And this court should not overrule the district court's finding under.
So, counsel, I want to ask one more. I know you're running low on time, but Judge Nelson's being nice to me. So if that's your position, kind of going back to the mootness, I don't remember if we discussed that in this case or in the last case, but would you agree if that's your legal position, then you would think they could do it again for another similar period of time and that would be completely lawful? So it's hard to see how this case would be moot. Do you agree this case isn't moot because of the possibility of, like, let's say COVID swarmed back in again and suddenly we're putting more restrictions back in place? You would agree that your position is that you can lawfully put this kind of restriction back in place again?
I would agree with Your Honor that the case is not moot because of the nominal damages. How? Because of,
I know, but that's not my question. I'm talking about the capable of repetition aspect. Would you agree that that's also, given your position on the merits, wouldn't you agree that it's not moot because of capable repetition?
We are in the pandemic, and these orders were at the very early stages of the pandemic when people were dying in droves every day, and the infection rate, there was no vaccine, there was no way to stop any of the spreads, and our health officer was acting quickly and swiftly and ordering general neutral.
So, counsel, I understand. I understand. It's a little bit of a non-answer. So, just maybe I'll ask it as clear as I can. Do you think the county could impose the same restriction it already imposed again, and it would not be unlawful?
I think that what we've learned, what has been learned about COVID, and what has been going on, and for now, with over a year and a half without the restrictions in place, I don't think that there would be a place where we would be back at that again. However, I'm not,
that seems like it's just totally made up. I'm having trouble sorting out what is in the pleadings, what is in the record, and what is made up by counsel on the fly. As far as, oh, this will never happen again, well, gosh, we didn't really know that the Delta variant was going to come along and raise the numbers back up, and the curve of infections and deaths was going to rise again. Who knows about the Gamma variant? My gosh, what about Rho and Tau and all the other Greek letters? We could even get the alpha-alpha variant when we start around the alphabet again. It sounds like you're just making stuff up to say it'll never happen again.
I was certainly not making stuff up. I was just trying to respond to Judge Van Dyke's questioning. And this was not addressed at the district court level. So that's maybe why you will not find it in the record, but I was responding to Your Honor's position.
Okay, counsel, thank you. Thank you for your argument. And we'll turn back to Mr. DiGiuseppe for rebuttal.
Sure, thank you again. And I think it's obvious that the defense feels like it needs to run the Jacobson, and that shows where it feels like it needs to be in order to be salvaged here. And another point on which Jacobson just
doesn't
control.
But they also argued that this does still satisfy intermediate scrutiny. And I guess I don't know if you have anything
that's
more
true.
To say about that. But.
Right. On intermediate scrutiny, I think I've exhausted that ground. I think we see that there is no particularized justification for it, not one that would satisfy this court's case law. The reality is this court doesn't have to do anything extraordinary to do the right thing, because the case law is in place that you need. There doesn't need to.
That Judge Van Dyke has raised, that we've watered down what intermediate scrutiny means to the point where it's just rational basis scrutiny. And I think it would be hard to justify the position that this regulation would not satisfy rational basis scrutiny.
I don't believe that your case law has been that watered down for the reasons already discussed, Your Honor. I think that it firmly would be a problem under the standards of intermediate scrutiny. Otherwise, they have absolutely no teeth whatsoever. And there is definitely a difference between rational basis and intermediate scrutiny. Plus, this court, too, has recognized that rational basis can't be applied. So I don't think that there is anything much more that we'd have to do in order to get to the right result.
Satisfies rational basis scrutiny. It's reasonably related to a legitimate end.
I apologize for interrupting, Your Honor.
That's okay.
I think there was a cross of the microphones. I don't think it's reasonably related. Like with the Jacobson standard, as broad as that may be, it still said that it was subject to the analysis was subject to the guarantees of the Constitution under federal law. And importantly, in Jacobson, there was an out. The guy could have paid a $5 fee and avoided the vaccine. There was no out here. And if there's
$185 in today's, when I heard $5, I didn't think it was that much, but I'm cheap, and $185 dollars seemed.
Sure, which is not insubstantial, but there's still an out. And then we don't necessarily have to get wrapped up with intermediate scrutiny, because this is actually strict scrutiny, or if not more, it really is. I think the court could reasonably find that that's where we are with its case law, recognizing that, like, for example, just even a ban on proficiency training, like there was in the Azell case, this court recognized in Jackson that was a proper understanding to actually use strict scrutiny there. And we don't just have range training, we've got the whole gamut of firearms activity. So if there's hesitation, you've got strict scrutiny, you've also got...
We don't have any law yet that says strict scrutiny applies, do we?
In your case, in your circuit, I think that you do, because you have case law that makes clear in Bauer, Sylvester, and in Jackson that restrictions which operate as a destruction of the Second Amendment right, and we have a temporal thing, it's true, but as we've seen through the arguments, relying upon the temporal nature of it is really problematic. So if we don't get fixated on the temporal part of it because it's just too problematic to rely upon, this was a destruction of all of the core Second Amendment rights, and therefore that's strict scrutiny. And it really goes to the level of categorical unconstitutionality as well under the settled law. And granted, this court hasn't applied it to find something unconstitutional in the Second Amendment realm very often. That's true. But this is a different case.
It really isn't.
The cases have to be.
It isn't the suspension of all Second Amendment rights. As your opposing counsel said, if you already have a gun and ammo in your house, you're fine. Just don't go out of your house.
Sure, I understand what you're saying, but we're talking about a multiplicity of rights being implicated here. And under the First Amendment, you've got lots of different rights in a bundle of sticks, which can be implicated. Obviously, the more that are implicated, the more severe the burden. I don't think there's any question that this was a severe burden, if not a destruction. And even if it's a severe burden, that's the strict scrutiny standard that this court has applied.
On a limited class of people who need the Second Amendment, it's people who did not previously have guns and ammo in their house and have decided they need them. It's, or people who've had guns and ammo in their house for years, but they haven't gone out to the range and maintained proficiency for years either. Those people have their rights suspended. The people who are proficient and have plenty of guns and ammo and their gun safes at home, they're fine.
Yeah, my concern with that, though, is that we're treating the right as lesser than the others. And this court and the Supreme Court has made clear that we can't treat the Second Amendment as lesser.
Well, if we are treating it as less, I mean, all the rights have qualifications.
Sure. But I don't think in that particular analogy for purposes of distinguishing a lesser degree of treatment or a lower level of scrutiny is what we should follow because of the vast extent of the ban here and the burden on the right.
You know,
I don't want to think
of ordinary experience, I guess, and I don't know anyone in Alaska who's been there a long time and does not have plenty of guns and ammo at home. So it does seem like
right,
it
but
only
I mean,
affects a limited group of people.
Well, that also assumes that people have ammo for the guns they already have and they couldn't get it. And the Constitution protects their right to not only get it, but then practice with it. So I do think the result is clear under the law that's established, and this court shouldn't have to struggle to get there. And I appreciate your time.
Thank you, counsel.
Thank you,
to both counsel for a well-argued case, and the case is now submitted.